The New York Yankees need to add a starting pitcher. They've been linked to multiple starters on the market, including Blake Snell and Jordan Montgomery in free agency, but what about the trade market? What options are available for the New York Yankees to go out and get and bolster the rotation? Today, we look to answer that question with four guys the Yankees could look at on the trade market to go out and get better, and we did not include Corbin Burns, we did not include Dylan Cease, and we did not include Shane Bieber because we wanted to get creative and give you guys four more options to look at based on some reports that came out about pitchers that teams may have been listening to offers on or pitchers that could actively get dealt. With that being said, make sure you guys like, comment, subscribe, and turn on the notification bell so you guys can be kept up to date on all the new content we've got coming out. And without further ado, let's get into today's video. First on the list is right-handed starter Edward Cabrera, who slots in at the back end of this list because he's the least accomplished starter of the group, but has incredible upside. This past season, Cabrera went 7-7 with a 4.24 ERA across 99 and 2/3 innings pitched, striking out 118 batters and posting a 54.3% ground ball rate, but struggling with command and walking 66% of batters as a result. He's got blistering velocity, and because of it, he had four different pitches finished with a stuff plus above 105, but his worst pitch in the metric was his changeup, despite it being his most reliable offering. Changeups tend to grade out poorly in the model, but his changeup is a unicorn pitch. In the pitch tracking era, he has the highest average velocity in a changeup at 92.7 miles per hour, and while his pitch usage against right-handed hitting could use work, it's something that the Yankees could probably fix by tweaking the usage of his four-seam fastball, since it just hasn't gotten the job done against those matchups, and his slider could be a better pitch he relies upon more in those situations, not just for swings and misses, but soft contact as well. He'll have to cut down the walk rate from 15.2%, but I think he'll be able to do so by trying to attack the zone more aggressively and being less concerned about being beaten in zone, as he could overpower hitters with his pure stuff and velocity. For now, he profiles more like a 4 or 5 starter, and projections believe he could be a solid addition to the rotation with a 4.18 projected ERA for the season. It's not a bad mark at all, and while the Yankees would likely need to add a bit more depth to make sure they have insurance, he is an excellent pitcher to take a flyer on. As for a potential package, the Miami Marlins would reportedly look for immediate infield help up the middle, and shortstop is a massive position of need for them. Oswald Peraza could offer the Marlins some help defensively, as the team doesn't have much depth in the upper levels of the minors, nor do they have a stable major league option in terms of shortstop depth. Peraza is projected to put up a 97 WRC+, and while that's still a below average bat, with his great glove and speed, he could end up being a valuable member of their infield. The Yankees have also reportedly found out that the team has a fourth MILB option for the 23-year-old, and that creates more roster flexibility for any team that acquires him. From the Yankees' perspective, they will be adding a starter that they desperately need to the back end of their rotation, and he's somebody who could improve in New York. There are concerns about command and injury, but those risks are risks the Yankees can afford to take with some of their upper-level minor league pitching depth. It's a low-cost option that keeps the Yankees in position to trade for an ace at the deadline if need be, or sign pitching depth for rotation or bullpen, and it makes the rotation considerably better. If the New York Yankees can pull off a deal that includes a player like Oswald Peraza, who they likely won't be able to play much this upcoming season, it's a win for the team. And for Miami, they get an option in their infield who has control and can flourish in a full-time role, which could provide much-needed stability to the middle of the infield and form a great infield duo with Luis Arraez. Bryce Miller is one of the most exciting young pitchers in baseball and would cost more than Edward Cabrera despite being the same age and having an ERA slightly higher than Cabrera's in his career. Miller has an excellent four-seam fastball that has a 121 stuff plus and carries his arsenal as his primary offering. This past season, he went 8-7 with a 4.32 ERA with 119 strikeouts and 131 in the third innings pitched, walking just 26 batters and displaying excellent command and aggression in zone. His biggest issue is his inability to prevent damaged contact, which does kind of play from the fact that he's so aggressive in zone, as while his four-seamer is excellent, the lack of command and feel for his secondaries limits his swing and miss potential. He has tried a myriad of breaking balls, and while his slider has been a solid pitch, it's not a great whiff pitch, and then his sweeper has been downright awful. They both have had issues preventing damage contact, and they're also in zone often, and specifically with sweepers, big, loopy breaking balls that find themselves over the heart of the plate are just begging to get crushed, even if it's to a righty, even if it's to a lefty, it doesn't really matter. It's not like he's also got a great secondary pitch to pair with the bad breaking balls, like if he had a great changeup or he had an excellent cutter, but that is something that could change very soon. He's developing a splitter that he's flashed online, and he has excellent vertical separation off his fastball on it, and while we'll have to wait and see how he commands it in big league games, the addition of a splitter would be excellent for him. His issues aren't against right-handed batters. They've struck out 25.5% of the time against him and only have a 549 OPS, but the issue is left-handed hitters, who have tattooed him for a 558 slugging percentage and an 18.4% strikeout rate, which is something that you could imagine a splitter would help him with. He's got the elite level 4 seamer to have a great fastball, and it's released from a low slot with 18.4 inches of vertical ride with a negative 4.3 vertical approach angle, which is absolutely elite. His 4 seamer is as good as it gets, and with a splitter that can become a plus pitch and a gyro slide that we mentioned earlier that's solid but not great, this could combine for a great 3 pitch mix that's coupled by his ability to mix in some fastballs like a sinker or even the occasional sweeper to just throw hitters off. He's made a total of 29 starts last year between the majors and AAA, so the Yankees also know that they would have an arm who would take the ball every fifth day, which is extremely important for any rotation, but specifically theirs where they have a lot of question marks. And if the Yankees are able to add a stable starter like Bryce Miller to the rotation, not only would it be ideal, but it would also be a big boost for their floor and ceiling. But at the same time, if you look what the Seattle Mariners are going to look for, they're going to want multiple impact MLB pieces, especially in their infield, considering that they just subtracted Jose Caballero for Luke Raley, and earlier in the offseason, they salary dumped Eugenio Suarez. Oswald Peraza could also be a fit for them as well, but so could a guy like Jorbit Vivas, who's on the Yankees 40-man roster and could be called up at some point over the next year or two. Vivas is a guy who could also play second or third, so depending on how they view Luis Urias, he has some utility and some versatility in their infield. I think a package of an infielder like Vivas or Peraza, whoever they prefer, an arm like Will Warren, and a bat like Ben Rice could be the framework for a deal, but ultimately, I think the Yankees are going to struggle to match up well with the Seattle Mariners in a deal for Bryce Miller, because I think any Mariners fan would tell you that that three-player package really isn't the most enticing offer in the world. Perhaps they would subtract quantity for quality, looking for a more impact player, even if it's just one, kind of similar as how they did a one-for-one swap for Luke Raley and Jose Caballero, and perhaps they would want a guy like Gleyber Torres, even though he's on a one-year deal. It'll be interesting to see how the Yankees and Mariners end up matching up if they were to talk on a potential deal, but the Yankees do have a surplus of infielders, the Mariners have a lack of infielders, and Bryce Miller's a guy that they're listening on, according to Joel Sherman. Mitch Keller is one of the most underrated starters in the National League, and there was some talk about the Pirates entertaining offers for the right-hander at the deadline. Joel Sherman recently reported that they're listening to offers again, and while they won't actively shop him, I believe the Yankees could take Mitch Keller to the next level with how good their pitching development is and the depth of his arsenal. This past season, Keller went 13-9 across 32 starts with a 4.21 ERA and a 3.80 FIP, and showed off some added strikeout potential. While he struggled in the second half, allowing a 1.63 home run per 9 with a 5.59 ERA, the Yankees could make adjustments to improve his pitch selection and make him one of the better starters in the major leagues, with his issues against left-handed batters that could stem from the lack of a secondary offering that he can go to against them. His cutter was supposed to be the pitch he could go to in order to generate soft contact and avoid getting barreled up, but it allowed a high barrel rate and as a result had a 431 wOBA allowed against lefties. Personally, I believe that his sinker could be used more against left-handed batters since it would give the right-hander a pitch that he could go to and it can tunnel well with his other two fastballs. His sweeper could also be good for called strikes as his curveball just wasn't cutting it for him this past season. Mitch Keller is the kind of pitcher who could break out next year with a solid four-seam fastball and two other fastballs that have solid shape as well. His sweeper is also excellent with great horizontal movement. He shouldn't cost a fortune, but it won't come cheap either, and the Pirates have been looking for pitching and some infield help, especially at first base. The Yankees could potentially match up well with the Pirates in a deal, and once again, we go back to the Yankees' 40-man depth along with their farm system to put together a deal. The Pirates could use all kinds of position players in pitching, and while swapping an arm in the major league rotation would kind of open up a problem that they already have with their pitching depth, I think this is fine because they're going out and getting an upgrade. I think they could add depth in free agency or just call up a prospect honestly to be the fifth starter if they add Keller to the rotation, and for that, I think that Clark Schmidt can be involved in this deal with Everson Pereira and Ben Rice being an enticing package that gives the Pirates immediate MLB impact. That's a first baseman and corner outfielder for the team, alongside a cheap, controllable starting pitcher for the long term. And I think that this fits both parties because the Pirates are probably not going to pay Mitch Keller what he's going to look for long term. And the Yankees get a bulldog starter in Mitch Keller, who's going to make 30 plus starts a year, pitch deep into games, and has the upside to get better. Perhaps this is something we have to revisit at the deadline, but this could become a massive get for the Yankees and should be a name that the team looks out for this winter. The final pitcher that we're going to talk about is Jesús Luzardo, who is one of the most exciting young pitchers in baseball. The left-hander went 10-10 with a 3.56 ERA across 32 starts, striking out 208 batters across 178 and two-thirds innings pitched, and averaging 96.8 miles per hour in his four-seam fastball. He is one of the best pitchers in baseball, and while he doesn't have the most consistent track record, he's always been a breakout candidate, and that breakout finally came this past season. He's only 26 years old, turning 26 this past September, and he just oozes ace potential. He found a way to attack the zone more consistently this past season, and while I've always been a little bit bullish on him because of injuries and other inconsistencies, I won't lie, I definitely turned around after looking at his numbers for this video. He has a dominant three-pitch mix with an excellent slider, and this is somebody that the Miami Marlins are going to understandably ask a lot for. This isn't a player you're getting in a package headlined by Oswald Peraza, and if you're a prospect hugger, I would look away now before I make the package because I think that this is going to get a conversation started, not even get a deal done. The Marlins are going to need an outfielder for the future, somebody who's going to be their best prospect and give them security since it's still unclear whether Chisholm will hold up in center field long term with his injury history. Spencer Jones is the Yankees' number one prospect across a lot of outlets, and while this would be a blow to their outfield depth, it's the price of swimming in these kinds of waters, and yes, you do have to trade your top prospect to get a player you believe is as good as Jesús Luzardo. Augustin Ramirez would also be an excellent catching prospect to throw into the deal, especially since Miami needs catching help, and he's already on their 40-man roster and could be a long-term solution at a position where they haven't had an answer in quite some time. He has registered exit velocities north of 114 miles an hour, and on top of the excellent bat, he has a pretty strong defensive skill set that should allow him to stick at the position. Oswald Peraza could be involved in this deal more as a fourth piece in a throw-in, somebody that the Marlins can plug in at shortstop and could help bolster their infield as we talked about earlier, but this alone wouldn't get a deal done. Hell, I'd even argue it's not a competitive offer, and if the Yankees wanted to make a competitive offer, I think adding left-handed pitcher Henry Lalane would be a type of guy that pushes the Marlins to at least think about a conversation with the Yankees. He is a future top 100 prospect, he has remarkable projectability, and he's got a mid-90s fastball with a 6-7 frame, showing off excellent aggression in zone and having immeasurable upside in his teenage years. It's a four-player package that I believe could get talks going for a deal, but is it one that the Yankees or Marlins would make? Who knows? We can never truly know how these two organizations value the other players, and with that being said, I don't know if this gets a deal done, but what I do know is that Jesús Luzardo is worth the price of admission, and he is the type of guy you put next to Gerrit Cole in anchor rotation for the foreseeable future. Let us know what you guys think in the comment section below, and if you enjoyed today's video, make sure you like, subscribe, and turn on the notification bell as well, so you guys can be kept up to date on what we've got cooking this winter. We appreciate you guys sticking through to the end of the video, and check out our other social media channels if you want more of our content. We're on Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, and of course, we're on this YouTube page. And you guys can check out EmpireSportsMedia.com for all of our written New York sports content, including the New York Yankees. Thank you again for tuning in, and we'll see you guys in the next one. Peace out.